1 minus 1 by 3 gf minus 1 plus 1 upon 1 minus half g raised power minus 1, and the ROCL will be mod of g greater than 1 by 3 and less than half. This will be the ROCL. And this is contained in this case. Now, another property which is called shift property. Time shift. We said that if we have got a single action and it's yet transformed, is that of action is somehow. Say ROC of this is mod z greater than R1 less than R2. Then what would be the z transform of the signal which is delayed by k unit, of the signal which is delayed by k unit? Let's try to find out. And this will be really very useful. Let's try to find out z transform of this from this. That means if this is this, then what is this? Let's try to find out the transform of x sub minus k. X sub minus k from definition of z transform will be given of given by this. Now I write this point to make you understand something very interesting. When I introduce a transform to you, I output x is a function of n. The exponent of z is minus n. This minus n and n, they are equal in output. So z replaces n and you get x. That is argument I say. And this is a two-sided signal. Since this will hit, say, n. The range of n is this. Then in this case, n gets replaced by n minus k. So the range of n minus k also becomes this. Now let us solve for k. If I add k both sides, I get again this. That means in two-sided case, even if a signal is shifted either to the left or to the right, we won't lose any signal component. No signal component is lost. So, you can carry forward this idea. If it is n, this is minus n, then we can apply the same thing. Here we have got n minus k. So, let us generate a term, exponent here, n minus k. So, to do that, now if I compare these two, here g raised power k is extra. So to nullify this, I am writing g raised power minus k. Now here the summation is at n. So g raised power minus k is constant. So we can write this as g of minus k, n equal to minus infinity to infinity x n minus k g raised power minus n minus k. Now here also, x here is n minus k. The argument of x is n minus k. This is also n minus k. They are equal in amplitude. So z replaces this, we get the problem. This simple way of doing it. And now the ROC of this will possibly be modified, possibly, because of the presence of this. The ROC of x may get modified. Now, to lay stress on this, that if x is a function of n, we have got a exponent minus n, then n gets replaced by z, we get x. Let us use this idea to find out the z transform of subsimple functions. I am writing this defining equation. First, xz want to find out what is the transform x of u1. This equation. Now let's try to x of 2n from defining equation. The transform of x of 2n becomes x of 2n e raised power minus n. Xn is two-sided signal, xn will also be two-sided signal. It won't lose any component of that. Then let us somehow make x here is a function of 2n. So let us generate somehow here g of minus 2n. And if you can do that, then the job of this is very simple. Then we can write this as n equal to minus infinity. Infinity x of 2n g of minus 2n I want. So I can write g raised for half raised for minus 2n. Simplify this 2 to cancel and in fact this becomes g of minus 1. So no change. Now x is a function of 2n here. These two are equal in opposite. So this replaces this and we get z transform as x of g raised power half. Now, if ROC of xz was this, say, then ROC in this case gets modified. It becomes so you can use this idea to find out z transform directly. You can do it otherwise also. You can go for a substitution 2n equal n prime, so fine, then you get elongation. We'll continue our discussion on z transform in subsequent lecture. Next lecture is tomorrow again from 6. This base signal is known. So here again each z gets replaced by a inverse z. So, this z transform becomes g of minus 2 minus z d by dz and this becomes 1 minus a inverse z inverse cosine omega naught upon 1 minus 2 a inverse z inverse cosine omega naught then a inverse z raised to minus 2. Now you simplify this and you get the z transform of such a complicated figure directly without using by using the property of z transform. You don't need to do any direct computation if and while. That means the properties of z transform are really very useful and you can use them to solve problems and all that. Now there are some more property, we'll take it up tomorrow. It's better to take application of all those property which we have studied together. Now let us let's form a question and see how the property of different property of z transform help us in find determining the different information of about the system. Let's say a discrete time system. say I'm making a question in discrete time system. Is described by the following input, output, relation. Determining the system function. Yes. System. Determining the system function. Say. The system is Yn minus say 1.5 Yn minus 1 plus 0.5 Yn minus 2 plus Xn plus X n minus 1. This is system. This system describes a discrete time, this difference equation describes a system, discrete time system. And the object is, aim is to find a system function. To find system function, we have to go to G domain. So let us take Z transform of both sides. Before that, we should keep in mind, let us define Z transform of Yn as Yz and that of Xn is Xz. With this, if I take Z transform both sides, I get Yz, which corresponds to this, and minus 1.5. Look, if Z transform of Yn is Yz, then what is this Z transform of Yn minus 1? We have to apply delay property. If I apply delay property, then Z transform of Yn minus 1 becomes this. Then 0.5. Here again, we apply delay property to find out what is the Z transform of Yn minus 2 from Yn. Here the delay has been done by 2 units. So this becomes Z of minus 2 Yz. Now Z transform of Xn is Xz. Here again Xn is delayed by 1 unit. So Z transform becomes Z of minus 1 Xz. Now system function is defined at the ratio of output transform to the input transform. So Yz by Xz give the system function, which I can obtain from here. Yz by Xz, which gives system function Hz, which is given by 1 plus J inverse upon 1 minus 1.5 J inverse 0.5 J of minus 2. So this is the required system. And from system function, we can get a lot of information. Lot of information. That means, what are the, where are the poles and zeros of the system located? Poles and zeros of the system located. So, let's add this part to this problem. Let's try to find out what are the locations of poles and zeros. Know that any system Hz can be represented as a ratio of the two polynomials, numerator polynomial by denominator polynomial. The finite zeros of the system are given by equating n z equal to 0, and finite poles are obtained by equating dz equal to 0. If I compare these two, then this becomes 1 plus G inverse becomes Nz. So zeros of the system, zero of the system, finite zero. Is given by 1 plus J inverse equal to 0. That means J is equal to minus 1. At J is equal to minus 1, we have got a 0 of the system. Now, whole of the system holes of this system are obtained by one minus 1.5 g of minus inverse 0.5 g of minus 2 equal to 0. Now if I multiply both sides by g raised power 2, then I get g raised power 2 1.5 g inverse 1.5 g, and then we can factor it as g minus 1 and g minus 0.5. So poles are located at j is equal to 1 and j is equal to 0.5. So this system has got two finite poles and one finite zero. This way we can represent what you call poles and zeros. The information we can find, and if we know the poles of and zeros of the system, we can have many information. We can check the step. Determine question. Determine the Z transform and the ROC of the signal xn 3 2 raised power n minus 4 3 raised power n given. We have to find out this Z transform. You can observe the signal xn is composed of the two parts. One part is 3 into 2 raised power n given, and the other part is 4 into 3 raised power n given. Both the parts are causal signal because of the un being the multiplying, u of n being the multiplying factor. So, if you remember that for causal signal, the ROC is the exterior of the circuit, then you can do it very easily. So, xn can be written as 3, 2 raised power n, un, or minus 4, 3 raised power n, un. Now, as I advise you, that if you remember the Z transform of some basic signal, see of this, which is this, with ROC mod Z greater than mod A, then you don't need to compute the Z transform of this type of signal over and over. Now we can, if I use this, I can write the Z transform of this directly, which in this case will be xz 3 upon, I am comparing these two. So A becomes 2. So this becomes 1 minus 2 g inverse, and for this will become 4, and A becomes in this case 3, 1 minus 3 g inverse. Now requirement here is mod g greater than 2, and here mod g greater than 3. The Z transform of this signal will converge to this only when this condition is satisfied. The Z transform of this will converge to this only when this condition is confirmed. The Z transform both the signal will be converged to this only when both of them is simultaneously satisfied. So what is the simultaneous solution of these two inequality? That gives mod Z greater than mod 3. So this is the ROC. We will continue this discussion of Z transform in subsequent lecture. Thank you for today.